unstoppable. So thank you to all of you for being here. Thank you to Penguin, Millie and the team for putting this event together. And thank you to Ravi Burman, President of the Old Students Association of Hindu College, and Kuldip Dhingra for their graciousness and generosity. Please buy it, and I hope after this evening, Penguin, you may need have another beverage very, very soon. So let me take you very quickly through the agenda of the evening. After I finish, I will be in conversation with Kuldip Dhingra. We will talk about his life, we'll talk about his journey. After that, we'll open up for questions if any of you have questions to ask of him or to me. Then we move upstairs for the cocktails. And for those of you who want to buy your own copy, and please, no sharing of books allowed. I am very, very, very clear that as far as my books go, there is no sharing. Everybody needs their own copy, right? And there are many copies outside. Please buy your own copy. Now, just to tell you a little about the person that I've written in Unstoppable. So, Kuldip Dhingra is the co-owner and chairman of Berger Paints.
Yeah, Rishma.
His family has been in the paints business for at least four generations, and he is very proudly carrying forward this tradition. And today, he is the chairman of the eighth largest paints company in the world. Second largest in India, but eighth largest in the world. And the journey of Kuldip Dhingra is noteworthy because it would be difficult for all of us sitting here today to imagine or to believe that less than 40 years ago, he was a shopkeeper in Amritsar. And we'll talk more about it when we have our conversation. And from there to being the largest exporter to the Soviet Union and then buying Berger Paints from Vijay Mallya, it is a fascinating story, and I have enjoyed every minute of it. Besides being a paints man, Kuldip Dhingra at heart is a family man. And there is nothing better that he likes to spend than to spend time with his family at home. It's extremely difficult for those of you who know him. It's extremely difficult to drag him out in the evening, out of his home, in a large gathering like this. And for that, I'm really, really thankful that he agreed to be here. And he's also a great storyteller. And I hope that he will tell his stories and, you know, in his inimitable style as we have our conversation today. So without further ado, it's my privilege, it's my honor, and I'm delighted to invite Kuldip Dhingra to the stage. Conversations with many people who are present here, and if it wasn't for their openness and their generosity of time and of course yours, I don't think Unstoppable would have been possible. So thank you all once again for giving me your time and you know, the generosity of your time. So without further ado, so your brother's here. I can't see Ashi is here. So Ashi is your younger sister, Rupachan is your younger brother, and both of them, in their conversations with me, said that they were terrified of you. You became as a age 10, you saw yourself as the man of the house. And so what I want to ask you is that wasn't your, you know, the time that you spent in the military school? Or was it something that you did? How did you, at the age of 10 years, decide unilaterally that you were the head of, you were the man of the house?
The point is, I think my mother was not a very strong person. And my brother, older brother, he was in IIT. And there was this trauma. We lost our father.
Yeah.
So I really felt now I'm the father, like, to them. Yeah. So it was that kind of a responsibility. I wanted them to study and to, you know, get good marks and things like that. So, but I also told them, Arish, I see in your comment you mentioned, which I read in the book, I didn't know, that I also told them stories about
it. Yes.
Whether you're naughty or something, you like them and all that. So I listened to the
mixture. Forward to that.
Yeah. So they do say that you were a very benign tyrant.
But, you know.
I don't know how many of your people would say the same.
I promise you, I never thought they thought I was a tyrant. But I read in the book. You know, she never, that way, so Sonu being a professional, I think she researched the book for
about a year. Yeah.
1 year. It's a huge research. Countless people she met and talked to them and got information out of them, which, you know, they wouldn't have shared with anyone else, including me. She also got things out of me, out of my cousin. But she's professional in the sense she did not share, and neither did I want her to share with me, because it's her book, what people said about me. So therefore, she only shared with me what she tape recorded, my conversation with her, and that also she said you're not allowed to change anything, only dates and names and factual errors, which I said fine, that's fine. So a lot of things I've read in the book, Sonu. They were surprised to me. and knowledge for the, like, with Pan Papa. About my, Pan Papa is there.
Yeah.
About the doctor
yeah.
who operated on my father and killed my father.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that was all news, I think, for all the family.
Yeah.
That he's the same doctor yeah. who operated on my uncle.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how he sort of yeah. was saved. So yeah. that was a eye-opener, really. And you only you could get the story out of him. And rest of the family doesn't know their story, including our family.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there were also many, many things like that, which I learned from the book. So the book was also very interesting for me.
Okay. And actually, a lot of your cousins shared a lot of interesting things, which I don't know, should I share with them?
you should.
Maybe I should.
So,
as one of your cousins who's now in Florida, I think husband's papa, he shared, so I'm just sharing something which I think it's also in the book, that Kuldip Singh always wanted to be the leader of the cousins, and he didn't want to lose in any games.
I vote for it.
So
he's my best cousin.
So and then the only way that the cousins could irritate him was to call him Tony.
Yes.
And Tony was also their dog.
Tony was not the dog, Prince was the dog.
But he was called Tony.
No, that was another.
That was your nickname.
Somebody else's
dog. Neighborhood, there was some
neighbor.
Dog called Tony.
Neighbor.
So, Kuldip tried his level best to tell the cousins not to call him Tony and not to do it. Coach Tony.
You were the most.
And then he says that it was only when I ran after them and started beating them up that they learned their lesson. So, that's
otherwise they won't listen. All of them gathered. Kirpal is there. We've grown up together.
Yeah.
He was so upset. He said, how come I was not interviewed? Who knows you better than me?
My bad, sorry. Okay, so then, so you, now that we've established that you were a benign tyrant in Delhi,
I don't agree, but.
And there was another thing that Ashi told me was that in golf links, all the girls wanted to be your friend and they used Ashi as their route to get to you. And you also. And things didn't change in Amritsar either, right? When you moved to Amritsar, and we'll come back to Amritsar a little later. So let them go back to your college days. And after your college, you went on a backpacking, hitchhiking trip in Europe. Now please remember, all of you, that we are talking of 1967, when India was a completely closed economy. You were not allowed to take more than $8.
$7.
$7. So how did you manage? And some of the things that you did there, would you like to share with everybody?
You know, the plan was, it was supposed to be, you know, 19-year-old. And lots of us want adventure and all. So this was not coming in the way, this $7.50 and all that. Wanted adventure, which means being the hitchhike. So there's no question of traveling expense, find a job, and work the way through. That's there. The other friend of mine, initially Kirpal was to join me. Kirpal and Sarabjit Singh, who was a chess champion global, he and three of us were to go. Last, you know, I think month before the trip, his mother sort of said she got scared that it's too dangerous and not. Kirpal had to he could not go. So Kirpal was in the group. So the two of us went, and his father arranged $200.
$200
each for us at $7.50. So 1500 paid it, 1500 each. So we had $200 as a reserve each, in addition to the $7.50 which we got from exchange. So that $200 in those days was quite a big amount, especially when there were books which were sort of very popular, Europe on $5 a day. Of course, we managed at $1 per day. Youth hostels. We stayed in, took membership in international youth hostels. So stay in the youth hostel where it was very, you know, low cost, really. And at the same time, you shared work. You cleaned the rooms or you washed the dishes. You took turns like that. So the living was cheap. And for eating and all, you bought some bread, butter, cheese, and that was very cheap. So we were laughing at that book that $5 a day is too much. $1 na chalana. Then I also bought, I'd taken with me some neckties and some, you know, semi-precious jewelry and all that from the Janpat, which I thought I'd sell over there, make some money. But I managed to exchange, I got a tent and a sleeping bag we had. Mm. Sarabjit's father arranged the sleeping bag and this $200. Mm. It was taken off on the slide.
Yeah.
That was not allowed to market. So in Istanbul, I managed to exchange, one tie and some jewelry, that semi-precious jewelry, and I got a tent. So I had a tent, so I could even pitch the tent and sleep.
And then there's also that little phase in your hitchhiking days when you were in Holland, and then you were going door to door selling subscriptions. I've heard it from you, but can you just share it in, you know, how was it knocking on doors, speaking in a language you didn't understand, you know, one turbaned guy in an all-white neighborhood, how was that?
So the manager, you would drop us in different areas, doctor's area, that kind of areas. So they had mapped out where we could go, we were dropped. If we sold three magazines, subscriptions before lunch, because then we would regroup for lunch. Then you got a bonus. And if you sold 5 in a day, then another bonus. So I used to wear a turban. And it was, 1967. It must have been a pretty sort of rare thing. Now lots of people are there. And a youngster going around trying to sell these magazines. In Holland, they do speak English. But still, 1967, still some people would say they don't speak English. So the company had sort of made us bug up the initial pitch that I am with a group of students, it's a competition. They made it look like a competition that we are working in the summer and we get so many points, etc. Actually, you're getting money. So, but it was legal. Police did carry it. Once the police came, because somebody must have said these guys are doing some business and all that. They're coming around, so the police took us and we showed the papers, the manager came. So it was legal. But to get sort of like a sympathy, it was like a competition for salesmanship. And therefore, if you buy my magazine. And the magazine, it was a very interesting concept because there were magazines for football, there were magazines for boxing, there were magazines for jewelry making, you know, all kinds of hobbies. Magazines were there from America, Europe, etc. And then again, so some people are very stubborn. They said, no, but I don't have any hobby. Then the answer was, but I have a magazine which is for people with more. Can you imagine? And then they said, I speak this language. Oh, we've got that magazine in this language also, like that. So it was a really hard sell. And luckily I was a star salesman. 5 magazines, my second day onward, so therefore I was making heaps of money there. But initially, Harshad was, we took the job together.
Okay.
I met Harshad, Harshad was the husband.
Right.
I met him on the trip. He was also alone at one point, I was alone, so we joined up and we took the job together in Paris. Paris International Heritage Group, jobs, search for jobs to answer 3 interviews, got all 3. Both of us. But this was the highest paying one. And the other one was cutting grapes and all in champagne. And that was lower money but more fun.
And so at the end also the Dover prison.
Sorry?
And also reaching Dover in Quarter,
but there is a picture. We met there.
So you've been detained by the border police.
No, they were unfair. The British Indians that time, being Commonwealth, and I mean, we did not need a visa, right? So therefore, we were not supposed to take a visa, the Indians, for UK. So he said, I was asked separately. I said I'm hitchhiking. All my sort of record was there. I stayed in youth hospitals. I've traveled in Bulgaria, Austria, Yugoslavia, Germany, France. I've already been everywhere. So it's very clear I'm staying a few days. It's very clear. How much money have you got? I have very little money. So he said, that kind of a thing. I said, but what's the problem? I don't need a visa to enter UK. Why are you asking me all these questions? Yes, you're trying to be cheeky and all. So Harshad must have faced the same problem.
Yeah.
Not enough money. So we were detention meaning to be sent back. So we met there in the detention. So then we took a job and so we said we told the manager, can we sort of do these these salesmen. The sales trip together, we'll split the money. So we're doing that. And then he said, but both of you are doing that. He was paying for the hotel, breakfast, and all that also. So he said, but Kuldip is doing most of the selling. Why don't you split? So he made a split. Once he made a split, I was still getting the same sales. Harshad was not, he tried 2-3 days. So he could see that the boss will fire him. So he said, Kuldip, I'll take the champagne job. So he went to take the champagne, which was more fun, I think. So he took that job because we had all the job offers in our pocket. So he took the champagne job, and then we met again in Paris by chance. That's again the story.
Yeah, yeah. So then, you know, the door-to-door sales, I mean, I've been in business and I've done sales. Door-to-door sales, cold calling sales, it's the most difficult of all sales. So did you actually learn the art of selling and the art of persuasion during your days in Holland? Because today people say you can sell anybody anything.
No, it was my first sort of attempt at selling, my first experience. I suppose they saw a different looking guy who could speak decent English, and so they wanted to ask also whether you know what you would do and all that. So that kind of a thing.
Yeah.
But it worked. Nobody else in the company sold 5 in a day. Or that is true.
And then you came back, and then you were in Amritsar, and you were sitting in the shop. And I think Ashi let me into a secret as to why you so proudly say that you were a shopkeeper in Amritsar. Because you used to sit in the shop in Hall Bazaar, and knowing fully well that all the girls would come to get a glimpse of you, right? How did that feel?
You know something?
No, I don't know.
The truth is, Ashi never told me that. I only read in the book. Ashi also never told me about the God thing that the girl wanted to meet me and all that. Also read in the book. Buddhi also little bit used to tell me. This one wants to meet you. This one wants to meet you.
So you're not answering my question, actually. when you were in Amritsar.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Really.
You didn't know
all
that.
I know is that.
But then, why did you ask your brother to start stocking fabric paints? You were doing industrial paints and industrial. So the fabric paint ka kya lena dena?
They were connected. Even now in Berger, anything connected with paints and all, I'm encouraging. So we started doing artist colors, poster color. And
who would come to buy the fabric paints?
Mostly girls. For Dhariwal. Dhariwal is near Pathankot. Oh, and this is, you know, very lovely. But I used to sell even pellets, canvases, art brushes, sara
singh. So that was your diversification into the product that was the first company that women bought, right?
But not by plan, because love for paint.
I see. Okay. So then let's move to Delhi, when then you started, being a salesperson for Rajdoot Paints and running a small scale factory out of Golf Links. We are not going to talk about it. If you want to know how he ran a small scale manufacturing unit in the most premium address of Delhi at Golf Links, you will have to read my book. Buy your own copy. No sharing. But after that, you became one of the largest exporters to the Soviet Union, right? Can you just take us through that journey? How did that happen? How was it dealing with the, we call them Russians, but Soviet? Why do you think that you became so successful?
It's like I think in most of us, it's like accidents. So it's by accidental, meaning I got a call. We had this office in Ajmeri Gate, and I got a call from a company called Jyoti Impex. I wish I had called the gentleman here,
Mr. Jain.
He passed away, but his son is there. I know him. I'm going to call him. So I got a call from his office, one Mr. Galgotia, who was his partner, that they have an order for Moscow Olympics of 1980. This is the call in 1977. And they need white paint to beautify Moscow for Moscow Olympics 1980. So. I said, sure. He said, can you send us 16 into 1 liter samples of the synthetic enamel white? I said, sure, I can, but against payment. No free sample. So they were a little surprised, you know. But I said, listen, you know, point is everybody can ask me for samples and paint their own. But when they sort of, he said, sure, please send us here and we pay payment against the, these samples. So they made the payment and I knew these people are serious. So they must have, they gave the sample to the Russians and the samples were approved and the order came for 50 tons. 50 metric tons was huge, you know. First order for us, it was the biggest order ever. And so we were able, then they gave us 3 months supply or something like that. But my brother, older brother, Sonu Bhasin, they produced in 1 month. And they were quite surprised. He said, here, I said, can we have some more? So cut the story short, we kept on supplying much before the delivery, end of the delivery date. And they kept us giving us more orders because the other companies were used to take extensions and strike over Barish Ali. So that kind of a thing, so the quantity increased. And but it was through Mr. Jain, Jyoti Impact, meaning he's the exporter. He was very sort of kind to me, very trusted me completely. He never asked me for any exclusivity, verbally or by document, that I'll never go to the Russians directly, that I'll always go through him. Neither verbally, never asked me. Normally, in agents, they don't introduce the supplier with the customer. But he made sure that I meet them, on his behalf, I entertain them, and things like that. They started at one point. I started asking me, "Can you give us 1,000 tons?" I said, "Please talk to Mr. Jain." You know, they're asking me in a sly manner. So I kept saying that this happened over 2, 3, 4 years. For some occasion or the other, they'll ask, try to get talk to me directly, and I said, "Please." So anyway, this happened. He was a big agent for them, importing newsprint, fertilizer. So he had a huge business with them, and he represented many companies, Fenner, Dunlop, Evo, so many. I was just one of them. And one day these Russians called me after many years to the trade office, and so they said, "We'd like to sign with you directly." I said, "No, but Mr. Jain is there." They said, "No, we have problems with Mr. Jain. We have huge disputes, we have huge claims on him. And he's sort of kind of blacklisted and all. And unless you sign directly, there is no business for you." "Have you noticed that your business has been going down?" they told me. So, because I'm refusing, and therefore they were giving less business to Mr. Jain. For some reason. So I said, "I thought maybe your requirement is reduced." They said, "No, we have this new problem with him. We have disputes with him." So I said, "You know, it's not polite. He's the one who introduced me to you. I have to go and consult my brother whether I can sign with you directly." They said, "I'll give you tomorrow 11 o'clock. Yes or no?" So I went straight to the factory from the trade office to Sultanpur. That my elder brother, Sonu Bhasin, must have been there also. I said, "This is the ultimatum they've given us." And my brother, you know, like a gentleman, he said, "You did the right thing. You've been doing the right thing all along. You've been ethical. You did not want to go behind Mr. Jain's back. You refused." I didn't sort of tell him also so much. I was refusing it as it's a right thing to do. Now, I guess they were noting these things down, the character of a person. There always used to be two people. I think they one noted down. The person they're dealing with, what kind of a person they're dealing with, they want to look for long-term partners. So I think so. I can only guess. So my brother said, "Well done." My old Papa said, "Well done. But we must compensate Mr. Jain. Because he won't sign direct. First of all, we have to ask his permission. If he agrees, then we sign. If he says no, we don't sign." Were told me. And if he agrees, we must give him some compensation to sleep well at night. So I said, "Okay." got a bag, airbag type. Put money in it. Went to his office in the afternoon, took the time, went to his office and brought his answer government. So I said, Jain Saab, this is what has happened. Bag, I said, sure, I see sitting there. So he said, go sign. I said, they've given. So I said, but you know, he says, everybody else has left me. All the other people had left me long time back. Tu hi gadha hai to mere se chipka hoga. Really? Because I was much younger than him. Tu hi gadha chipka hoga mere saath. Jo sign kar jaake. मेरे भाई साहब से बात करी थी मैंने, ये है तो ये थोड़ा सा कॉम्पेंसेशन. ओ माय गॉड, यू गॉट सो एंग्री. यू थिंक आर रिलेशनशिप इज मनी, पैसों की बात करता है. बहुत गर्म गर्म हो गया, मतलब गाना करते तो दफा हो गया. मैं दफा तो हो गया, पर आई लेफ्ट दैट बैग देयर. बिल्ली वाकिन बैग. यू सो एंग्री, सच अ नाइस मैन. गॉट दैट. Then I, next day, I signed for the bar.
No, so every time that we talk to you.
rise and rise.
So every time we talk to you.
There's many things.
You've always said, you know, tukka lag gaya, luck hai, pata nahi kaise ho gaya. So the question is, why all of this with you only? Why did he not share with you? Why tukka aapke saath hi lagta
hai? I think all of us in our life, I tell you, all of us have the flukes and the luck and destiny, and like our accidental prime minister. All of us are accidents, I'm telling you. All of us. I mean, right from birth, I think.
So you don't think that you've done. No, so you don't think you've done anything that has attracted success to you?
No. If there is anything, again, I. With credit luck, that you know, I reacted or I responded in a certain manner. Where that impulse come from? It just comes from some destiny on the spot and all.
Ethical behavior.
Sorry?
Ethical behavior.
Honesty. That's it.
But it doesn't pay everybody. lot of people who are ethical and honest, and my people take advantage of that. I've been the lucky guy who certainly worked for me. But most honest and nice people really get cheated. This is my, I think so. There are many, many honest or ethical people.
I think, Kuldip, it's constant hard work.
Yes.
Because I've been very
Jaspar,
close to you.
I was trying to get
it's been constant and consistent hard work. That whether anything is there or not, but this you have to agree
with. Again, you'll agree with me. There are very many, very hardworking people. And ethical nice people, they don't succeed. Please believe me.
Kuldip, everybody who works constant, consistent, hard work succeeds a certain amount. You've done much more than anybody else. But that.
If you really think about it, you will agree that it's 99.9% luck.
No, but I would say it is total focus on pain.
Yes.
Not looking anywhere.
Basically ethics and your commitment and your focus. Yeah. You've always been focused.
I think don't
brush that off.
And your motors are.
Now your motors are.
Yeah.
You can afford to be more.
We shall believe that it is only to God and hard work and focus and relentlessness.
He'll bring some messages and all. And he said something very interesting. He sent me a message. Stock market today has crashed. But your Berger stock is all time high. It's because your book released. I said, So I said, it's a fluke. He says, you're very modest, man.
Naresh, when I use that quote to sell more of my books.
this is what happened, you know, just an hour ago.
It's a good karma. It's really good karma.
Karma and then again is a destiny.
Yeah,
you are my friend.
I'll add, he has created huge goodwill. Because goodwill always comes around, you may call it Kunda, you may call it whatever. It's basically goodwill that is created along the way.
Yes.
So if you don't cheat anybody, that's ethics. If you are working hard, it's working hard, people see it. But his relationships have been very, very sort of giving.
Yeah.
So if you become like that, then naturally you'll somewhere or the other it'll strike.
Yeah.
It all
the cosmos
together.
Gives it
yeah.
back.
But along with being,
like
you must have taken a lot of risks where you reach. Because nobody can reach there where you are without taking risks many times.
Yeah, that's true.
That's
I think as a family, we took a lot of risks. And our uncles and all were worried that we were taking too many risks and all.
That's
but my older brother, he was quite he would take risks. He had so much confidence and such an optimist man, my elder brother, Superman, from Papa. Even to the extent of when we didn't have enough money, we tried to sell the golfing's house because there was no money. But there was no buyer. Or we wanted 3,50,000 for the house. The highest bid was 3,25, like that. So therefore, so we've taken risks. And I may be a little bit more risk averse. But some of a tiger then.
Yes.
He had strong belief in that we keep working hard, we'll do well. He was very positive, total optimist. And I'm a little bit more conservative than him.
Yeah,
but then I would follow him.
Yeah, but that conservativeness wasn't in display when you decided to buy Berger Paints. Here you were a businessman nobody had heard about. And here was Berger, a true blue-blooded multinational, Brit multinational, owned by Vijay Mallya. And he had decided to buy. He read that Vijay Mallya was selling off Berger Paints and he decided to buy it. Now, a small thing like Vijay Mallya already having decided to sell it to somebody else could not come in the way. So how did you, at that time it really would have been an audacious thing for you to say that I want to buy Berger. Why? How? Where did that confidence come from?
Okay.
And why did you decide to buy Berger?
See, this Russian business, Soviet Union business was so profitable. It was like pouring money. By the time 1989, 1990, lots of money was there. And I could not believe that this will last. I felt it was like a dream, but this is going on. I just wake up and it'll be like a dream because it was too good to be true. Huge volume, shiploads, mothership ends. I mean, shiploads were going off, thousands of tons of materials of different types, which are all given in the book. Unbelievable one, record, world record, whether it was detergent or paints, etc.
Yeah,
so
can you just reel off all the things that you were exporting?
Too many things.
Too many.
Paints, pigments,
detergent, scouring
shampoo,
powder,
toothpaste, sewing machine,
motors,
shaving cream,
even onion.
Even
onion?
No.
No, not onion.
Okay, so back to Berger.
Also, countless. And now, so my luck again, I'm saying destiny. I could reach out to Brinda, who was my friend from childhood.
No, but that is when you reached out. What
made
you decide?
I thought that, see, when I was doing Rajput Paints in Delhi, it was growing extremely well, highest growth in the industry, but on a small base. There's nothing. So, and we were very happy because we were growing nicely and the profits were growing. Now, when this Soviet Union thing came, this was a completely different league. We were making more profit than Asian banks, but nobody knew because we were not public. So, and if somebody asked me, but you're doing very well in Russia, how is the Russian business? So I had to tell them it's very bad. Horrible. Because I don't want competition. I said, rupee, ruble, horrible. So, keep a lot. And they would like to believe that. Because, they were failing. So grapes are sour, so I made sure he had grapes. So never. But our used to is thousands of tons and huge volume. And,
thousands of crores.
Hundreds of crores. So, I mean, very, very large. Because export prices were low. So there's no excise, no income tax, no sale tax, no octroi, nothing. You got incentives plus. So the export value was much lower compared to the domestic value. But, so therefore, the value was less, but the volumes were huge. So now I thought to myself, this dream can't last. This is too good to be true. So it will crash one day. And then, you know, the rifle paints I had given to Sunil. See, Sunil here?
Sunil
here, yes, yeah. Sunil Sharma, there he is. So he was made the manager. He was from Narrowtech Paints, the blue-eyed boy there. So he is a professional manager, so handed over rifle to him. And I focused on export because there's more money there. So I said, now, when I come back to rifle, this is going to be very boring for me because I'm used to big, big turnover. And suddenly I'll be back to this thing. So how will I deal with it? So money was there. A lot of money was there. So when this opportunity came, Berger, so I said, let me buy this. It's paint only. And I had huge respect for Berger. I never knew it was so bad that I came to know how to be cold. So then it was, so I said, let me buy Berger. Then at least if Russia, Soviet Union, all this business crashes, then I'll have something big to look after. So that is the reason. But before Berger, I had already thought of this, that I want to buy a bigger company because this can't last.
And the corporate world.
I had to buy something which was meaningful compared to what I got used to.
Family business.
So I won't name the company. So we tried for another company which was offered to us, and Rajiv Sani was the advisor for that company, and we traveled and all that. And it was a bigger company than even Berger, and more profitable. So we got the deal. But meaning they were ready to send to us, the company gave us a concession compared to the other bidder, because we were from the paint business and the other person was non-paint. So £150,000 would discount there, you see. So a lot of money. But I said to them, listen, I know this company. We were, you know, supplying paint to them. We were also making paint while we were doing a rifle paint. We were supplying paint to various big paint companies. They were getting the paint made from us. So we were making under their brand, they were buying from us. So this was one of them. So I said, look, I know this company in and out. We supply to them. It's a little window dressed. The book decks, you know, a lot of our bag decks, a lot of raw materials and the finished goods stock which are shown there, they are actually bad and they are showing as full value. So I thought, this price is not acceptable. But the other party took it at that price and regretted it. So we let that opportunity go. So then came this Berger one. And thanks to Brinder, who was a confidant of Mr. Vijay Mallya,
yeah,
that this happened. Again, that an accident. I could have not reached Vijay Mallya. It was just this very strong relationship between Brinder and Vijay Mallya that he could reach him, and then he made this happen.
Seven days flat.
And what is amazing for those of you who may know about this is that Kuldip didn't check what was, besides the turnover, you didn't know anything about the turnover.
Not even the turnover.
So he just decided he wanted to buy Berger and you bought it. And I must tell you, because I spoke to a lot of people at Berger, I don't know any of them are here today or not, they tell me they were horrified when they heard the news that one businessman from Amritsar had bought Berger. And Berger was a multinational, a Brit multinational. They were used to colonial lifestyle. They were, you know, with stiff upper lip. And they were trembling. And, you know, Kuldip has a legendary temper, which he claims now that it's, you know, he's mellowed down. But at that time, I think it was in full flow. So they were very terrified. about their new owners. But over a period of time, I think they saw that you knew more about paints business than they did. But what I find interesting, and I want your comment on this, is that, you know, that was a totally professional company. You know, IIMs and engineers, and they were all running. You came in with the street smartness of a small businessman. How did you ensure that your two cultures actually gelled well to create the success that is Berger? It could have gone the other way. You know, professionals going one side, the street smartness going the other side. How did you manage to gel the two cultures together?
Yeah, I didn't go alone. I took Rajiv Sani as my as a director. So he was experienced in these matters. Anil Bhanda, Anil is here, there he is.
Yeah.
So he's a very proficient chartered accountant. So I had one very senior CA. I had a lawyer who had huge experience in corporate. So these were the people who sort of were my arms and they handled. So while they were handling it, I was, you know, learning.
Honestly, tell me, did you ever feel scared about, you know, dealing with?
I kept quiet. Just listen.
So now that Berger is the second largest.
So no, he listened, but he got it so fast. They didn't know what hit them.
Yeah.
It took him about 3 years, and he was on top of everything.
Yeah. No, so that's what I've heard from the senior management at Berger, that they really didn't know what hit them, because they were not used to the chairman or the vice chairman knowing, showing them different ways of doing the same thing. So, but I think they did realize that it was for the better of the company. So now that Berger is the second largest in India, and I think we discussed that it was the eighth largest in the world, or maybe
in architecture, the eighth largest.
Yeah.
Otherwise, 14th.
But as a
growing.
standalone. I mean, if you don't take Dow and the others,
if you take away all the, you know, the non-architecture, I think it's seventh.
It's the seventh
global.
Largest. Yeah.
And in Asia, in the top four.
So,
and South Asia.
So now, and this is amongst the last question, what more do you think that you need to do? And don't say that, you know, kabhi sab tukka hai, sab lag jayega.
So one thing we are very clear, I think, as a family, that we don't want to diversify. Because we've seen that paint producers, successful paint companies who've diversified from paint, they've lost the paint business. We have not seen even one company, even globally, who is in the paint business and is diversified and successful. So it's in Japan, in US, in Europe. If you want to be in the paint business, our conclusion is that you have to stick to it. So therefore, we just stick to this and grow in the paint business.
So we have a lot of, you were a young entrepreneur once, many years ago. We have a, you know, when entrepreneurship wasn't such a buzzy word and such a aspirational word as it is today. Today we have a whole bunch of youngsters, entrepreneurs. What advice would you want to give them? Because you from an entrepreneur, from a businessman, you moved into the big boys club here to Persia. What is that advice that you can give them?
You know, giving advice is not like sort of preaching and all.
Yes. Please preach. I'm sure they will love it.
But you know, I don't believe I can preach. I believe it's been luck. Okay. but they can read. They can derive their own lessons from it. How it's happened with me. Otherwise, I don't want to preach. I want everybody to also listen.
So then I'll draw a very nasty conclusion. You don't want to share the secret of
my secret is I never planned anything. It just happened. I took things as they came. And I reacted as per the situation, analyzing that under these circumstances is the right thing to do. So So therefore, as things came up, I decided. I didn't follow any. I didn't have any ambition. I never planned to become big like this or anything like that. And I don't know when I'll become smaller. Because wealth, what is my wealth? It's a paper wealth. A stock market price. It may crash tomorrow. This happened with many people we know. So it's an illusory. It's not a solid wealth. It's the stock market, speculative kind of a thing. So long as the people are supporting our share sales, tomorrow it can crash also. So it can disappear. So I'm quite aware that it's worked like that. Nindaresh, you are a stock market guy. Yeah. We've seen many people who were, whose stock prices are like that. Today they crashed and all. So, but all I can say is yes. A common thing is, of course, you must work hard, you must be sort of ethical. 100% correct.
And what
people should trust you. How can you work? How can you expand? How can you grow? Unless people trust you. Your employees should trust
you.
Your customers should trust you. Your suppliers should trust you. The word should go around. This guy is trustworthy. The reputation is important. So these are the key things. Don't make mistakes and all that. Don't try to be over clever or this thing. There are too many over clever, cunning guys. I think. It paid off for me because they saw, the Russians probably saw, I said that's not that transparent and they could trust me. That's it.
And that's one thing actually that stands out, if I can give my input, is that this strong focus on family values. I think that is something that has been, the constant that I have heard, and I have, when I've spoken with you, just talk about the family values, the role of family. Meeta's been there with your side throughout. Gurbachan's been there. Your Babiji is there. Your brother's not here. Ashir is there. She was there in Russia. What is the role of family and the family values?
I think that was very strong in the family. As a family, we should stick together. We are there for each other. Also, it made a lot of sense for the, frankly speaking, to do well in business, it's better to stay together, united and all that. Because you split, there's too much of wastage and united family is like, for example, when Meeta was not well, I was away for six and a half months. I didn't worry because my brother is there. So there is a huge support system. So I don't think I could have survived or we could have succeeded if we were not a united family. It's one of the secrets of our success, whatever it may be, is because we stood, and no matter what happened, we stuck together. And my older brother also is very realistic. So he also said to me, we should stick together because then we can grow. He said, one day we will split. Like you born, you die, everybody has to die, family has to split. Brothers, no matter how well they are, they will split. But let's try and work for a long time together, the cake is bigger. So when we split, we have bigger slices. So this was his philosophy. If let's try and stay many years together, the cake will be bigger. And then we will split because that's inevitable like that. So this was his wisdom.
Good, so I am done with questions for you. Anybody has any questions? Can't hear you.
And why? Oh. And I would say unstoppable is unputdownable. It was strange reading for me.
Who would you like to play yourself?
No. When you wanted to write the book, I had no conditions. Again, Now you must tell them what happened yesterday. There were no conditions. So she'll answer the question. There is, she has some information of a meeting yesterday.
So I don't
know. Please be honest and tell them what happened.
I don't know what, I mean. So yesterday, there was this guy who came from Bombay, and, you know, he does want to make a film on Kuldip Dhingra. So one thing that you need to be very, very careful about Bollywood is that there's many a slip between the cup and the lid.
Yeah.
The intention is there. Hopefully something will work out. And we did talk about who should play him. We did talk about names like
when I'm young somebody and then I'm older somebody.
Yeah. So hopefully the project should see the light of
day. Give us some hints. Let's make some ideas.
The one he named, I told him, I said, I don't watch films because I tell you this happened in this film, that happened. I said, I don't watch films. And so I really, please excuse me for my lack of knowledge in films. But tell me. So he was suggesting.
The younger one?
Yeah, the younger one was Dilip Dosanjh.
Okay.
And the older one was Akshay Kumar. When I'm older. I said, it's your money, it's yours. He said, you know, it has to be a big deal, but we need two permissions from you. Okay? Two conditions. Number one, that it's going to be big deal. That's how big, small is your problem. So, and the other one was, we take liberties. We have got creative license. So, we have to create a villain. They will be a villain.
A villain.
So I said, there were many villains in my life. I can't talk about it. So I said, no, you have the permission, because if you're going to spend money and all that, I would like you to earn money, etc. So I'll support you in the sense that I, whatever cooperation I can give, like when Sonu was, you know, sort of writing the book, thinking, who buys biographies? I mean, biographies so boring, you know. And I wouldn't read people. So Meeta also said, you know, so I said, Meeta, now they're wasting their money, Penguin, and so on. All she wanted was, interview you at your convenience on Sundays, holidays, 2 hours, and record me like that. And she did all the work. So I'm very happy. It's been a big success.
Okay.
Very happy for saying it. Very happy. So I told you, I'm very happy this is a success, so I'll support you.
Yeah, so you will have to, your on-screen avatar is going to be dancing around trees. Any other questions?
As a leader, one of the challenges which people of our generation face is that younger people have a different mindset. You have had experience of working with, you know, small as a retail outlet and then large organizations. What will be your advice, how to actually manage the younger lot and get either them to understand our mindset or us to understand their mindset?
You know, this is a very sort of tough question. Either I can use phone of friend or
Besides luck.
You know, I'll tell you, when I was in school, I read this very interesting book in Amritsar in the school, and I that Khalid Gibran book,
yeah.
The Prophet. So in the Prophet, you know, people ask him questions in that village, and he answers. And there are about marriage, about children, About children, he says, and I believe that for the younger generation, he says that these children are from you, but they are not of you.
Yes.
They have their own mind and all. So don't be too attached to them. Let them go. They don't, they want to. If they are yours, they'll come back to you.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they were never yours. So I really don't want to impose, because they have their own mind. Each child is different. So I really believe they'll answer their own calling. But if they ask me some questions specifically, I'll be glad to answer. But each child comes with their own chip. Now we know chip. There's a chip, and everyone comes with a specific chip set by God. So implanted there. So that's why each child is different. So they will answer their own. And we shouldn't try to impose ourselves. Let them fly like that. But and youngsters do come to me with specific issues. And I'm very happy to talk to them.
So, Mandeep, if there are any youngsters, please tell me. We'll organize one Gyan session with him. Right? You had a question?
Simran? Simran. Yeah, you remember I've talked to youngsters?
Yes.
And it happened with others also.
Of course.
So therefore, I'm very happy to meet youngsters.
Yeah.
They have to come to me and ask me.
And specifically.
And specific questions and all. I'll keep answering.
I agree.
Yeah. Thanks for a very honest and entertaining conversation. I thoroughly enjoyed that. The question is related to a couple of things which were said here, and also millennials coming in, but changing consumer choices, consumer preferences, as well as disruption. You see, this is the age of disruption, where businesses are being attacked from all sides. And I heard you say that you don't want to diversify, but I guess that doesn't mean that you're not planning for disruption. How would you do that? Do you think about that you know, this business could be disrupted? And if yes, then what do you do about it? And any innovation, you know, planning or systems in your company?
We are extremely worried about this, that disruption can happen. You know, this brick and mortar, this paid business can completely change. Many businesses have died. So we are very, very concerned about that. And in our board meetings, we sort of keep addressing this question all the time. It's a big fear. So what we do is, it could be e-commerce. So we have started, we've gone to the e-platform. People can start buying our paint from you. So we are blocking all those things. Service, we've started offering that we paint your house. This is not offered anywhere in the world. So in India, we started, an Asian sort of copied us, express painting, that people may go for service rather than buying the thing. They want the execution. So we've done that. Then technology. Paint is chemistry. It's changing every minute. Formulations, raw material specifications, the new raw materials come, how you mix them, the skills. Somebody may come with some product which I don't have. So therefore, R&D. We've got 77 scientists in Calcutta, and then every factory has. So we want to be ahead. And there's right now no product anywhere in the world in decorative which we don't have. We are ahead. So that, because we are scared that nobody should make something or come out with something we don't have. So therefore, we try to keep abreast, and that's why we have not allowed any foreign companies to come and sort of take over the Indian market. In fact, we are the one which are here, they are losing market share because we are offering more. So this is it, by trying to block all the possible disruption areas. Yes, we are very worried about that. Naresh Gujral is on the board, and he knows how scared we are of disruption. But because we are scared, we keep finding solutions to stay ahead. Yes, it's a worry.
Thank you so much. I think that brings up a couple of qualities at least I can take from there. One, of course, is the fact that you understand the nuances of the business very well. Any business that we get into, we're talking about qualities, right? And you said it's all luck. I think one of them is that you understand the nuances of the business very well. The other thing is leadership, which is associating with the right people, okay, hiring the right people, or you know, that bit. So leadership, I think, is a great quality.
Anyone else? Jaspal, you don't need the mic.
Aaj chami andi ho
gaya. Okay, Kuldip, you made it very clear that you want to stick to the paint business. And it's very clear that if you don't expand, you'll get bored, and I don't see you getting bored. Now, if I was to say you've got two options. One is to venture into new kinds of paints in India, or to venture overseas. Which would you pick, or have you thought about these two possibilities?
We do for
expansion.
We do both.
So you're looking at overseas?
We are already happy.
Okay, good. Thank you.
We are in various countries here. We are in Bangladesh, where we are 60% market share. 60% market share of Bangladesh is our company. And it's also a listed company there.
60% is like dominant?
It is dominant. Yeah. It is dominant. Asian is number two at 15. So one-fourth our size. And it's also a listed company. And it's one of the highest market cap in that country. So we are in Bangladesh, we are in Poland, we are in Russia, we are in Nepal, we are in UK, France, Ukraine. Now we are in 8 countries already, and we are trying to buy more, trying to buy a company in Russia, trying to expand here. Then in the paint, in the field of paints, there are allied lines, like we now be entering, marine paints. So there are some niche areas in paint which we keep expanding.
Question, Jaggi?
Kuldip, we have met a few times. The thing which has always struck me about you is your sense of humility. For you being in such a dominant and powerful position, it's not often you see people at that position who are humble. Where do you take this sense of humility from?
No, I think
when we brought up, we were taught to be such a, humble and all that. So I think it's something we habitually. Your father was a very famous and very respected man. But our upbringing was like that, isn't it?
Well,
please explain. At least in our age, it was very important. And we grew up.
Yeah, we were also told that humility and modesty are like underwears, indecent in the show.
But do you feel you've changed in success?
Look, I'm sure I must have changed. Because, circumstances must have, I can't judge that. But people who've known me in Amritsar or people who've known me in college.
No, he hasn't changed at all.
K. K. Well knows me from 1964. Kripal knows me. Kripal, have I changed?
Okay, any other question? Because now we are standing between you and the cocktails. But like a very known economist said, there's no free lunch, so you'll have to buy your copy of the book.
One more question. You didn't tell us the lead actress in your movie.
I'm not choosing. In any case, I won't be in the movie myself.
So, boy,
if I was acting myself, I would be the one choosing.
That's very
thoughtful.
So, we'll get you to do a cameo, right? Any other questions, or shall we just wind up?
But Dipti, my daughter wants to be Ashibua.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She wants to act as my sister.
Okay, thank you for. Yes, Surinder.
No, I don't need it. It's okay. I said in the whole presentation today and discussion and question and answer, I stopped on one very important factor. a pillar of strength in his life.
Yes.
No mention. In his initial rise, I think the support that he received from her needs to be mentioned, and special mention made. Okay.
I started to, you know, when I got married, I was petrified.
Tell us more.
Meaning, you know, the expenditure and responsibility, etc. So I said, now I have to work harder.
She was a great entrepreneur herself.
Huge.
She made a success of her business.
So successful that, you know, her business at one time was maybe even growing more than mine. So, and the girls were a little bit. So I was not a male chauvinistic type of a guy. So I didn't want to say that, you know, now you have to sort of shut down your business. Or you have to look after the children. Both of us can't be working full time. So I told her very seriously that, you know, one of us must shut the business, because otherwise our children will get neglected. So I said, I offered. She did not agree, but I offered in all sincerity. But I leave and sort of look after children and all. Such a career. I did ask you.
No comments.
Very politically correct.
So, again, since we are on this topic, I think everybody, especially from your family and the people who know both of you, everybody, and in fact, Ajit kind of scolded me to say, why haven't you written more about Meeta in the Inheritance? No, no, but he said, you cannot write a story without, you know, Meeta being there. And everybody has, you know, kind of said that you wouldn't be the man that you are if it wasn't for you. So tell me, call it a day and call it an evening.
And celebrate this big success.
And thank you, everybody, once again for being here and taking time out. And let's just move out. Thank you.